Alright, so today I'm going to give you some STEM infused lesson examples. We're going to talk specifically about the T in STEM, and then I'm going to give you a whole plethora of technology tools, ways that you can apply them in the classroom, and then we'll have a little bit of time for reflection, maybe if I don't talk too much. No guarantees though. So this first section is all about different STEM lessons. So these are focusing primarily on cross-curricular lessons where we were trying to connect two content areas at the same time. But you can do math and science or math and English in the same period. So this very first one focused on the linear equation. I love lines is what I titled it. It was applicable for Math 1, also for physical science, so it's a lesson that you could easily modify and use in a math class or in a science class. So this lesson used the Video Physics app, and it was to address the common misconception of not understanding how movement, what the graph of movement looks like. So students were shown a video of a man losing his car at the top of a mountain and watched him struggle to regain entry into his car, and then asked to identify which line represents his movement in that video. And nine times out of ten, most of your kids are going to pick option D because car went down the hill. So this lesson really helps to address that misconception. So students are given an iPad. You can also use this app on your iPhone. And they were given a Hot Wheel car, awesome, and a ramp. And we had specially built ramps, but you can easily do this with a book. And then a couple textbooks stacked up, and just to create a nice ramp. It's not really super high tech as far as that goes. And they need to partner up, so you need to have a driver. They let go of the car, goes down the hill, and the kids use the app to video the vehicle's movement. So what's really cool about this is with the video, the kids go back and track the movement of the vehicle using the application, and it gives them a really nice graph of the movement of the vehicle, and so they're able to see that the graph does not go in a vertical line down. They're able to see what the graph looks like. Then an extension of this, you can tell them to go back to the original question and to try to replicate all of those different scenarios. So they'll find out that one of them is impossible, that they can't do that. But it's a really nice extension of this lesson, and really gets kids thinking about what movement looks like. This is another one dealing with linear relationships. So you can see the standard there. Kids need to understand how a scatter plot works with a linear equation, or how to fit a scatter plot, scatter data plot, to a linear equation. So this lesson is done using connects. And you could easily do this with a Lego that you build, the Lego cars that you can build. We picked connects because they're a little bit easier to put together. And we've used them with all levels of kids. We've used them for some elementary track out lessons that we've done. And kids are able, elementary age kids are able to easily put together the vehicles or all the way up to the high school level. So they have directions, and you can see here the kids are using the directions to build a specific vehicle for this, or kids can also just build their own. And we've given them, here's some wheels, here's some parts, go to town, make something that will drive. So they build their vehicle, and then they go outside. And this particular one, they use the Spring Racer motor. So they had to pull the vehicle back and then let it go and see how far it went. And what they found was that relationship between how far back they had to pull it, measuring that, and then how far vehicle went, made a really nice linear plot. So they had to gather 10 different data points and come back to the classroom and plot their work on a graph and then find the linear equation to predict how far their vehicle would go at different distances that they pulled the vehicle back. The Kinex kits are, well, about $60 if you look for them on Amazon. If you buy them from the dealer, they're all the way up to, you know, we've seen them at $114 for the kit. You can build 8 different vehicles from one kit, and easily the kit can be shared between, oh, I don't know, it says 4, but I've shared it amongst 8 kits, just depending on how you partner them up. If you're not set on using this particular graph or force and motion kit, Kinex sets you can buy at Walmart for under $30. So it's a really nice tool to have to get kids thinking about motion and get them building. So this third cross-curricular lesson is looking at quadratic motion, something that often turns into a nightmare for high school students. It's no fun. So we tried to make this a lot more fun by incorporating the Angry Birds game. And so we've done this lots of different ways, but again, using the Video Physics app, we've studied motion a couple different ways. We have some slingshots that we got at Target in the, what's the dollar section, but they were $3 at Target. We also have used wrist rockets, which was terrifying. But the kids had a lot of fun with it. Just to give kids, you know, we had to have the conversation about if you take this and aim it at someone else, then it now becomes a weapon. And so you have to have that conversation. But the kids have a lot of fun shooting things through the air. And so again, they use the Video Physics app. You can see my pointer's not friends with my computer, but the pointer. To work. So you can see here, this is what it looks like, your video that you take. So kids line up from the side, the letter rip, and the other person videos that motion. And when they go back, they're able to plot the different points along their video feed. And they go back taking their graph. So this would be their resulting graph. They go back and create a data table from that, so they have to pull off, you know, a certain number of points from that. And you can even take this a step further and look at your quadratic regression. So find an equation for your line and then figure out how close it is to fitting your data set. So it's a really great lesson. It's really great if you want to start out your unit on quadratics with this lesson, because then you have a data set that you can go back and refer to. So let's say, you know, tomorrow we're going to learn about how to calculate how high your quadratic was or how far it went. Then you have this data set that you can keep referring back to. It also works really nicely for an end of the, you know, the culminating type activity. This is another setup that we got actually from Kinex that students can build that actually mimics the Angry Birds, but I will say that the Target, the $3 Target slingshots are probably my favorite for getting a really great quadratic launch. So, this last lesson that I'm going to talk about with our STEM lessons deals with exponential growth and disease, and I've used this in a couple different level math classes, and math 1, math 2, and also in a biology class. So it's a really nice cross-curricular lesson that can be adapted to do in several different content areas. So this lesson is based on the premise of how infectious disease spreads. So kids are given the problem of if you had one person with a cold, how long would it take, or how many people would they have to come in contact with to infect the entire school? And we were at Pinecrest High School, so there's 2,200 students there, so how many people would they have to come in contact with to infect the entire population of the school? And we took the students and did the old sodium hydroxide and phenolphthalein lab. So they, one kid has the sodium hydroxide solution, everybody else has water, and they go and make their swaps. After every swap they have, they go and deposit it into a well. So you have to do it in stages because you're studying the progression of the spread of your disease. But we, you know, we're teaching high school level kids, and we tell them any kind of connection you're making with swapping fluids applies. So in the real world, the clear disease that you cannot see, this is all real world. and the kids go through and test that using phenolphthalein. They're able to see, you know, after the first round of swapping fluids, how many people were infected. And then they tally that. Which I will try to change it with my pointer. That isn't working. They go through and tally that, build a nice data table, and graph that, and they see a really nice exponential curve. So the technology piece of this is using an app called Play Ink. And when I found this app, I found that a lot of my students already had it because they think it's fun to play. Has anyone heard of Play Ink before? You have. So you guys are missing out. So Play Ink is based on the premise that you're trying to infect the entire world, and so your disease wipes out the entire world population. Incredibly morbid. And that's why kids love it, because it's awful. So they're given this world graph. They have to first decide where they're going to start their disease. So you can have all kinds of critical thinking problems. You know, what conditions make the disease, or, you know, are more conducive to spreading disease? You know, what kinds of populations would you want to aim for? Kids have to do some research and decide where they're going to start their disease. It goes back and forth between being a free app and not being a free app. I think it's either 99 cents or $1.99 right now. But it does also work on phones as well, and the kids probably already have it. So they start their disease. As you move along the progression of the disease, you have some options for mutating your disease, so awesome biology connections there as well. So you can mutate as far as transmission or symptoms or the disease ability. So then again, you can have some really great conversations about, you know, what types of symptoms would make the disease spread faster, because you're trying to wipe out the population of the earth, after all, you know. And so your end objective is to infect the entire population. As the disease progresses, you can go around and look at the different infection levels in each country, or you can look at your disease progression worldwide. And the best feature of this app is that it has math. What? And in one tab, you can actually look at the graph of your disease transmission. I tell kids, you know, keep going back and checking and looking at your graph, and they can see how their disease spread exponentially. So a great application. I had a kid who then would try to take the iPads for the rest of the semester and play this game. So I'm not sure what that says about him, but whatever. So this next section, we're going to focus primarily on the T in STEM and on technology itself. So when we're thinking about this, I want us to focus on what our classrooms look like. So we're thinking about this awesome pencil skirt wearing 1940s teacher versus a teacher that could be in any of our schools, in any of our classrooms today. So really quickly, let's talk with your table, discuss differences that you see here. I'm gonna give you about 30 seconds to discuss what is the difference between the 1940s classroom and today's classroom. So there you go, there's your time. Yeah.
Versus individual desk.
There's our timer. So, does anybody want to share some things that you noticed? What about the skip here? What did you guys notice that was different from our two classrooms?
We discussed how in all the pictures, the students were just looking at the teacher, that they could be engaged, could not be engaged. Whereas in one model picture, at least it looks like they're engaged. They're all looking at computers and one to another.
And nobody's playing
video games. At least that we can see, right? Mm-hmm.
So. Yeah, I like that point. As well. Any other differences? What about this table right here?
They're seated together to collaborate versus, you know, directly looking at the teacher, and each student has their own technology device.
Awesome. So there's lots of differences that we see in this. And the one we talked about was too, same thing. You guys said that, you know, the focus of their attention is really different. When we think about technology integration in today's classroom, we know that our students actually learn different. One of my favorite articles was written by Mark Krinsky, It's Not New, which I think is kind of telling in itself, that this article's been out since 2001, but he identifies today's learners as either digital natives or digital immigrants, which I'm a digital immigrant. But many of our students today are digital natives. They have known nothing but the internet. They have knowledge at their fingertips, not necessarily that they know how to use it, but how they get their information is markedly different. So in my graduate research, and then also with the Governor's Teacher Network, I tried to look at research on learning. So what do we know about learning and technology? And the frustrating thing that I found is that there's not a lot of research being done in the U.S. about how our kids actually learning when we use these technology devices. Most of the peer-reviewed research that I found was international research. So you can see these names don't sound American. But this research was done in India. So you can see here that we have the technology integration class. This is for a physics class. You can see their technology integration and then the control. So it does indeed look like there was an increase in learning. And then you also look here in the data in between the difference in learning between males and females. So in our male cohort, there was, again, an increase in learning between our experimental group and our control group. And then also in our females in this group. And one thing that you might notice, and this was in the earlier group of data as well, that in the second semester, there was little to no difference in learning and the study. The study attributed this to the type of content they were learning in the second semester. So it was more spatial, and you know, being physics required more hands-on, and so during that unit, there really wasn't any difference in the control group and the technology infused group. So kind of interesting to look at. I conducted some of my own research as part of this. And part of this had a student survey, so looking at students' perceptions of the technology-infused lessons. The sample size was 1,743 responses. So here's the responses for one of the questions. The lesson was interesting. So contrary, you know, sometimes we don't care, but it is important if students find a lesson interesting. So you can see that well over 70% of the students found that this lesson, lessons that integrated technology, were indeed interesting. And then again, well over 70, almost 80% of the students would like to do more lessons like that. So a really positive thing. Then when we get to kind of shaky ground, did they learn? you know, some positives here. This is looking at pre and post data, and you can see that the mean for this group was at 51.4. So you had an average of 51.4% learning gain for that group. The frustrating part about my research was that it was really difficult to get teachers to agree to be the control group. So no one wants to be the other group. So you know, obviously that is an experimental flaw. Other things that we looked at were the students' comments, and I found it kind of interesting that that 198 students of the 1,700 surveyed replied something, you know, cool, awesome, along those lines. So some positive comments. Most of the negative comments had to do with the devices themselves, because we did use Apple devices, and some people just didn't like them. Can't please everyone. And then also with poor Wi-Fi connection. So anytime we had negative comments, it was about that. So some of the other research, we know that our students have access to a plethora of information right at their fingertips. So we need to figure out how to help them peruse this information highway. And we also know that our kids learn with games. So there's a lot of research about how kids learn with games. So this is some great research by a woman by the name of Jane McGonigal, and she advocates for gaming in education. This is just some of her statistics that she's found in her research, but you know, just this average that by the age of 18 or the age of 21, kids spend 10,000 hours, an average of 10,000 hours gaming, and that's more than the time that they spend in school. So by the time they're 21, they spend more time gaming than the total collective time that they spend in school. So as teachers, are we going to be able to compete with that? No way. But what we really need to focus for is getting a piece of that. If we could just get a portion of that interest and that attention and that passion that kids have for gaming, that would think of all the positives that could happen from that. There is some research also about gaming. So looking at gaming and games in standardized testing. So one research study showed that there's a 50% increase in learning with kids who were playing an educational game because they wanted to go back and try to beat the game. So they were exposed to the content more often. And there's also a study in Florida where surgeons at one particular hospital, where they're doing specifically arthroscopic surgery, so it's things where they need a lot of hand-eye coordination, they actually warm up before their procedures by playing video games. And they said it didn't really matter what type of video game. He's playing the Wii here. They played all different types of video games. But they made 37% fewer errors in their procedures by warming up using video games. So we're going to move over into this next section and talking about technology tools. But before we do that, I would like to take a couple moments just to talk about some of the issues that you have with integrating technology in your school. So let's take a minute this time and share with your table again about troubles that you have, issues with integrating technology.
Laptops for
everybody.
it's kind of hard for us to listen.
With the computers.
Yeah.
But they used to Microsoft.
Yeah, I was going to say, when are they getting used to Word?
They don't.
I think it's
Google Word.
So there's really no.
It's a bit different from the other, from the regular one.
Yes, it is.
We can talk for the next 30 minutes about issues that we have with technology integration. I know that my people back here shared that they just don't have enough devices. So it's difficult to integrate technology if you don't have devices. And you know, what, depending on what your policy is about bringing your own device, there's a lot of issues that go along with that as well. Let's see, this group here, would you guys like to share some of the issues that you have?
We said the same thing, and then just reliability, like with the Wi-Fi, the time it takes to, get everybody on the computers and get everything kind of set up, and then if halfway through the lesson, the Wi-Fi cuts out, or, some battery dies, or whatever, because we're all at the same school, so we have the devices, but it's not always necessarily reliable and very time consuming to go through all this effort and have it not work.
What about you guys?
Same thing. We need the strength so that they can actually do whatever projects we've decided to do.
Well, to go along with this, I have a couple different recommendations, things to consider. So obviously you want to consider article impression, like you're thinking, yeah, right? But to go along kind of with our technology and use Bloom's taxonomy, this is a different way of thinking about revised Bloom's taxonomy, created by Kathy Schrock, and she's the author of the Blooming Guide for Apps. Schrock's Guide to Everything. But I really like how this represents the different levels, the levels of higher order thinking, and that really no level is higher than the other, but recognizing that they all kind of can contribute to that creating level. So this is the way we're going to focus at it today. There's also another really interesting guide that looks at the verbs. So the verbs we have are kind of based on pen and paper, different activities. These verbs focus on the technology tools that we might be using. Another thing that we should think about is the TPACK model. So more research on technology and education, but this is just acknowledging that if you think that it takes time and that it's difficult and it takes more work, this is just basically saying that now we have this whole new circle here that is a new knowledge that you have to have. And so if it feels like it's more work, it is, because this is a new level of knowledge that you must have in order to effectively integrate technology. So when we think about this, always recognizing that we consider our content first, our pedagogy then, and then lastly, we choose our technology tool. And sometimes it's really tempting to say, oh, this is a really cool tool, I want to use it. But we have to consider our content first, our pedagogy, how we're going to teach it, and then choose the tool that's appropriate for that level of thinking. Some last tips, think about your TPACK, your Blooms, consider student technology level. So you might have a variation in your class, so you might have some students that work faster, some that move slower, you might want to consider that. Pre-plan your pairing, so probably don't want to put your ADHD students together, to work together. So pre-plan your pairing. And then, most importantly, how are you going to have your students turn their work in? So that's something that you want to think about ahead of time. Is there a link? Are they going to email it to you? Are you going to collect it through a Google form? So that's something, students will notice if you don't have them turn in their work. They won't feel that your project is valid if they don't turn it in. So all the resources that I'm going to talk about are shared on this Pinterest board. So if you want to jot this down, is anybody a Pinterest fan? My co-teacher this last year was a male teacher, and every time we would do presentations, I would make him talk about Pinterest board. I always think people pay attention to a guy talking about Pinterest. Mm-hmm. But guys can have Pinterest too. So the very first level we're going to think about is the remembering level. We're going to focus on social networking. So one thing that we kind of tend to sometimes forget is what a tool social media can be. So one way to check for this level of learning or understanding is by having kids, you know, put out a quick tweet and have them tweet at you. And so you can get this in your feed, and then you have a really nice record of your students' understanding. Another really cool one is called Padlet. And Padlet is just a virtual collaboration board. It can be terrifying because there are options to allow students just to add to the Padlet board. You can also require them to have to go through a check before they're allowed to post, which is a little bit safer. Because it is a little bit scary when they figure out, oh look, I can write whatever I want up here. So you have to have some conversations. But there's a nice example. It works really nicely for formative assessment. If you want to go through, instead of, you know, your formative assessment questions, instead of having them write it on pen and paper, give them a link and have them all collaborate up on the Padlet board. You can opt to not show this until everyone is finished to help, you know, keep everyone honest as well. Back channeling is another really great way of checking at this level as well. Today's Meet now has an educational account as well, where you can require kids to only be able to sign in from certain accounts. You can kick them off forever if they act inappropriately, so they'll be blocked from your back channel as well. 81-Dash is another similar platform that is specifically created for education. Another really great tool at this level is called Video Notes, and it's a platform that works with really nicely with Google Apps for Education. So you said you have Chromebooks, this would be a really nice one for that. And it just works by allowing you to play a video and then take notes in the same frame. So that would be a nice one if you assigned a video to your students for homework and you actually want them to learn something from it. And Kahoot, y'all know Kahoot, please tell me. Okay. Mm-hmm. Our next level is the understanding level. We're focusing on blog journaling, also categorizing and tagging, and commenting and annotating. So one really nice digital application is called Timeline. It's by readwritethink.org. They have a lot of really nice different applications. This is one of my favorites. Timeline also has an app that you can use as well, but it allows you to create a digital timeline. And then for each of those different events that you have, you can even add more information and it'll print out a second page in a PDF form that has an expanded list of information about each one of your events. Trading cards is another really nice application by readwritethink.org. Trading cards actually started out as an app, I believe, and now also has the Web 2.0 application. You can use this for almost everything. It gives you lots of different options on the card that you're going to pick, so you can use it for a fictional person, an event, vocabulary. There's lots of different applications that you can use this for. For this particular lesson, we used it with a, used to be U.S. history, now it's American history one, class, but they had to look at a current event, or a more current event, so it prompts them also for each different box, which is a feature that I really like. They didn't used to have that, so kids would be like, what am I supposed to put for a description? But now, once you click on that little box, it even tells you, like, gives you a little prompt for a description. You might want to put, you know, what happened, something like that. So for each one of those boxes, it prompts the kids to do that. You can save this as a PDF, and it actually is formatted for printing. So if you want to print it We used this and actually created a timeline on the wall and put all of the events in order. So a really nice application. Another one at this level is called Poplet. Poplet is a digital mind mapping tool, and you can use it for lots of different things. I'll show you again when we get to a higher level thinking order. But for this, just to have students organize the information. So you can use it for vocabulary words. You want to have them create a word web. You can input pictures. You can change the colors. So if you want to make it really fancy and captivating, you can change the colors. And it also has a draw feature, but I'm really terrible at drawing with the mouse. I always tell kids, they always try it, but the draw feature, yeah, terrible at drawing with the mouse. But that's a really nice one. It shares with the link. You can also download it as a JPEG, so you can look at it as a picture file as well. Recite This is another application that's really great for this level, and it's really great for making a really quick poster. So this would be great for formative assessment. You know, give me a quote that you found, you know, make a bumper sticker, something like that. So try to do this as nicely as I can. So you type in, this is one of my favorite quotes for sure. You type in a quote and it renders different versions of your quote in different posters. So go back, you have all different kinds of formatting options. So kind of a fun way that you can have students do a little quick check at that level. Another really cool one, video logs, so they video and dialogue at the same time, a way that you can attach questions to a video. So once again, we want kids to learn from their videos. I know it's shocking, poor things. But a way that you might use this for a flipped classroom as well. So if you wanted kids to go home at night and watch a video to prepare for your lesson the next day, a quick way to check for understanding and get some accountability for that. Another one that's really great at this level is called Telegami. Telegami is not new, but it's just that cool. So Telegami is an application that allows you to create your own little avatar. You can give it a funny face. It has a text-to-speech feature that is not free anymore, which is sad. But you can also record your own voice, so a good practice for kids to have to get that verbal part in there. So here's an example of how you can use this in a science classroom.
Process of transcription. The DNA polymerase has unzipped a strand of DNA and is preparing an mRNA copy.
So it animates the little avatar. It does little gestures to go along with your voice. Here's one that we did for a U.S. history. So
March 28, 1979 at 4 a.m. in Middletown, Pennsylvania, reactor 2 of the Three Mile Island nuclear power.
So you get the picture, but kind of fun, just a fun way, and it's really quick. So this is a really quick way that you could check for understanding at the end of your lesson. So now at the applying level, we're looking at uploading, sharing, and also having kids edit different pieces of information. So I can't pick a favorite application, but this might be one of my favorite applications, just because it's different. So this is a way that kids can add information to a map. It's called ZMaps. So here's an example of how we used it for AP Earth and Environmental Science. They still study biomes. I think in middle school science you still study biomes. So it's a way that you can digitally add different tags. So they had a direction, a key. So for green you had to add information about the plants in your different biome. Black or pictures that they could add. And so this is just a way to tag something geographic. You can highlight by country, your you're limited, I think, to 5 countries, but you can highlight using the geometric highlighting feature. You can highlight as many different areas as you want on your map. And this also shares out with a link, so this is something that's easy to collect in the end. Easy is always good. ThingLink, see, this is right up there. This is one of my favorites, too. ThingLink is another tool, great visual, allows you to annotate pictures. So here's an example from a biology classroom. So this was one that we used where kids had to know the function of the different organelles. So they had to go through a picture and annotate the function of the different parts. And then the second little tag on each of the organelles is a video to kind of help them. So you could use this for a review piece as well, have them share it with their friends, and then they could go back and review the functions of the organelles as well. Great math application. We might come back to this one. Do we have any math teachers in here? You're a math teacher. Are you familiar with the Desmos teacher platform? We might come back to this one. Great platform by Desmos. So Desmos is a free online graphing calculator. It also has a free app. Both of them work really, really nicely. And then last year, they started a little classroom platform as well. So it has different activities that you can share out with your students, and then interactive games that they can do. So this shows the dashboard, showing you the different activities that they have. You can do activities looking at lines, hexagon shapes. There's one called Function Carnival that's probably my favorite, looking at different mathematical functions of carnivals, and then also Central Park. And so this is an example of one in the Function Carnival. Just gives you little different activities, draw a graph, so the kids can play it, look at his being shot out of the cannon, and then try to graph his movement. And then one really great thing is that it includes the written piece. So every so often it has a little checkpoint. It requires the kids to actually write out, you know, a little summary of what they've done, a little checkpoint. So it also includes that piece as well. While you have your students in this platform, then you can go back and look at, you also have in the teacher dashboard have access to all of your students' login. So you share out a code with them, and then you're able to see what each of them are doing. So if they're, you know, lagging behind, you can say, like, hey, you have a problem, or maybe you're, you know, playing whatever game it is they play at the moment. So really great platform. The next level is the analyzing level. So we're looking at mashing, integrating several different sources, so several different technology pieces or pieces of information, or linking. So here's Padlet again. This time Padlet was, you can change the background on your Padlet, and this is one I just took and created 2 interlocking circles on, I think actually on Google Drive. Screen captured it, imported it as a picture, and now you're integrating that higher level of thinking using the Venn diagram. And I think this is actually my student's work. So for the plant cell, animal cell, little comparison. Great check for understanding, a little bit higher level of thinking. ZinePal is another really cool one for linking information. You link in different websites, and you go through each one and pick which information you want out of that, and it puts them together in a mashup of all of the information that you selected from each source and puts it together in a book format. And the best part about it is that it doesn't make your kids little plagiarizers. It actually cites the source of where that information came from. So it makes them good digital citizens. Here's another use of ThingLink. So this is kind of a little higher order thinking application. If you wanted students to analyze a piece of art, so before it was just identifying, now if you wanted them to analyze, annotate, you know, comment on a particular picture, that's another way that you could do that as well. So here's how someone has done this with a particular piece of art, to comment about different features that they saw in that, or their opinion of of that piece of art. So now at our evaluating level, we're going to focus specifically on blogging and then also collaborating or networking. So one really great way of getting your kids engaged at this thinking level is by having them actually blog. And there is a platform called KidBlogs that works really nicely for this. You set it up. They each have their own blog. We opted to use Weebly because our kids were a little bit older and because it's such an easy web creation platform. So we went through and shared and made the pages and then shared each page with the students using their school email account. So they received an invitation, they were able to accept it, and then they could only go and edit their own page on their blog. And we did this for essential questions because essential questions can be uber boring. And so this was an attempt to try to make doing essential questions a little bit more interesting. So weekly they would have to go through and blog about their essential questions. So this is an example of one student's blog, and it honestly kind of makes me look bad because this kid, he could just leave and become a professional. I don't know. So this is one week's question, but you can see all the features because he put them all in here in his blog. So he has different little picture galleries that he had. He can integrate videos. So there's a video, different, pictures. This is still one week's questions. There's only a couple of questions. I'm not that mean. And then at the end, he cites the sources. So obviously, all of our classes didn't look like this, but this is one really awesome example. And he really got engaged in doing the essential questions that would normally not be very exciting. A very exciting task for the week, for sure. This is a newer tool that I found. I haven't used it in the classroom yet. I only played around with it a little bit, but I think it has great potential. It's called Real-Time Board. It's one of the first applications that I found that offers a live collaboration tool, and it works much like sharing does in Google Drive. So if you use Chromebooks, your kids will probably know how to share this and collaborate on the same tool. And it allows you to put all different kinds of content into your collaboration. So you can add pictures, it has different little colored sticky notes, you can just add text in there. You can write in there so they can talk about different ideas. It has a zoom feature, so I'm zoomed in quite far, but if you zoom out, you can see you can fit a lot of information. And then I think it's really cool because you can look at it conceptually as well. You can look at how your ideas flow together conceptually. So that's a great feature. It allows you to insert all different kinds of media, so you can directly load things from your Google Drive. So if you link it in there, then it will be loaded on this platform, and then you can view the document right from this platform. You don't have to go out to a separate link or things like that. Videos will load right on this platform. And then this one that I was playing around with is a real-time link to a web page. And so it links whatever view you're looking at a particular web page right within. I kind of do want to own an Apple Watch actually, but not right now. So that's kind of a cool platform. It also works on multiple devices, although it doesn't work on phone yet. I tried it, so they did lie a little bit about that. But they're in the beta phase still, and they're saying that it will work on phones, but right now it works on Web 2.0 or also on tablets. So kind of a fun one. EduBuncee is another presentation tool. I don't think I'm going to show you this one, but cool. Another way of linking different media together, pictures, videos, making multi-page presentations to link different media together. Here's another example showing Poplet at a higher level thinking. So this was a collaborative Poplet where students had to cover world religions. And so each group was assigned a world religion, each person in the group was assigned a different topic. So, hey, you're going to do texts, you're going to talk about, you know, different religious figures, you're going to talk about history, different things like that. And so they were able to share their one Poplet board together and collectively put all of their content together. From this, the students went out and created a video. So they had, everyone had access to all of the information, and then they created a video. So just kind of a higher level application of Poplet. So at the creating level, here we look primarily at filming, animating, video casting, and also publishing. So getting your students to publish. Animoto is by far my favorite video tool. It's been around for a couple years, but it's just so easy to use. And because if you have an educational email address, then they bump you up to the next cooler account for free. And so you have access to longer videos. You can put in up to 300 pictures to make a video, and then you get some really cool templates. So I always tell kids that, like, this will make you look like you actually know what you're doing when you make a video. And kids really like that for that fact. So it's also really nice. So if you're thinking about ELA, it puts it out into a storyboard format. So they actually have to plan out and think about how they're going to put their video together. So it kind of has that feature embedded. You can add different text on as a caption for the picture, or you can also add text in as a separate frame. It does limit you on characters, but I just have kids put in the little dot, 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 and then open up a new text frame, and then just make sure that those two frames are consecutive, and you're able to, you know, convey a whole thought in complete sentences. So I'll show you a really quick example. This was, used to be the old, like, poster on my family for French class. So the teacher had her students now bring in photos, either saved on Google Drive or on a flash drive, and then make a video about their family. So. So lots of different applications for this platform. You can see it comes out looking all professional and snazzy. They have lots of music soundtracks. They have religious tracks. They have holiday tracks. But, you know, different jazz, all different theme tracks. So kids always say they're going to bring in their own music content, but they never need to. So it's all, whatever they need is all there. MoveNote is another one that allows you to record a video using a presentation, and you explain along with this. So just another way of creating video content. It does have an application now, which is nice as well. WeVideo is another video application. If you have students that are a little bit more advanced level, it's probably the closest web application I've found that works like iVideo. iMovie, there you go, iMovie. So it allows you to work at a more advanced level if you want to work on different, you know, video line, your audio line, you know, music line, and edit at different levels there as well. Another one at this level is 123D Sculpt. And with that, Autodesk also has a lot of really great applications for thinking and having kids create 3D content. So this was a lesson talking about different adaptations, and kids had to design a creature that would have certain adaptations for their environment. And then our hope was to go and have them 3D printed, but we couldn't get them downloaded in the appropriate file size. But the hope was there. So kids went through and designed the little creature. And they were much better at this application, the sculpting, than I am. Like, it was kind of embarrassing, actually. So Issue's another one, creating, publishing a newsletter. Really nice templates, really nice to use. Some schools actually use this for their school newspaper now. So publish it and publish everything in a digital format that they just share out. So that one is Issue. Flipsnack is a good tool for creating digital storybooks. You can enter things as a PDF, or you can enter them page by page. Canva is a great tool for publishing and creating visual content. Has lots of templates. We've used it for having kids create a Twitter poster, an Instagram poster. You could create a Facebook cover, although our kids don't have Facebook anymore because that's not cool, because we have it. So you could create your own Facebook cover. Different poster templates. So this was a little quick application at the end of lesson. Here, create a Twitter poster. We talked about your ecological footprint. They have some different dashboard with different lessons as well, so can be higher up. And also, it's great what do you call them? Just totally lost my train of thought. And they're my favorite ever. What do you call them? Pictures with. Yes. So you can create those as well. They have great tools and applications to go along with that. Binkley Comics is great for making and creating comics to share. And last but not least. So if you would like to access my presentation, there's the link to the PDF on the web. Want to go back and access this. All of the digital tools that I shared today are on the Pinterest board, so you can go back and find those. If you click on them, it'll take you out to the different applications, and there's also information on each one. So if it's free, or if it's an application, or if it's available for iOS or Google Play, all that information is there as well. And then, last but not least, if you want to go back and look at the lesson plans for the cross-curricular lessons, those are all available on my website.